great to see everybody came out, even when we said we were going to be outdoors and it's cold. I'm Cindy Brownfield, and tonight we are talking about public works, and as you know, you're here at the Water Treatment Plant 3. Our featured councilman who is hosting this evening is Mr. David Ferguson. Mr. Ferguson was selected in just this past November to complete the term of the District 2 City Council member, replacing Frank Meeker, who ran for County Council and was elected Flagler County Commissioner. Mr. Ferguson received a Bachelor of Science degree in Engineering from Drexel University in Philadelphia. And I know we have some Pennsylvania folks here. He also has an MBA in Finance from Georgia State University. Some of his accomplishments include Business Strategy Consultant, Advisor Analyst in Flagler County, and Vice President of the Bank Capital Group, also in Flagler. Is that right?
Sort of.
He's always had a passion for politics, public service, and for not wasting anyone's time, as he so appropriately notes. He and his wife, Krisha, have 4 daughters and 4 grandchildren, and I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Ferguson. And then after he speaks, Richard Adams, the Public Works Director, will be doing the presentation.
It's hard for me to keep things short, but I plan to do that tonight. First of all, I want to thank everybody who's participating in this program. Number one, it says something about your involvement in the community, and if you're informed, you're a real plus to helping government do a good job. If we have citizens who like to get involved but don't know what they're talking about, that makes it harder for government officials to do their job. So I thank you for getting the knowledge that you're getting in these 5 sessions here. So you have one more to go, and maybe that'll be the capstone of your program. But this, for me, has been the most enlightening as far as the city, because I've been here in and out for about 9 years. I own property here for 9 years and moved here permanently last year. But for the record, I heard last week a lot of interest in what the new utility rates may be or may not be. But I brought my utility bills for Duval County, which is Jacksonville, which is 60 miles north of here. And I found it interesting to see what we were being charged by virtue of what we were using. We had a little less than a half an acre yard, and we watered it probably more than we needed to. So I won't talk about irrigation. But the water and sewer was typical to what we find here. My wife and I only empty nest household up there. We were using 2,000 gallons of water per month on average, unless we had company, and then the usage went way up. But just for example, when we used 2,000 gallons of water, we were charged $57. This was in March of last year. When we used 3,000 gallons, which means 3,000 gallons for water and sewer, we were charged $64. So I don't know what the rates are this year, but I bet you they're not lower than what they were last year. So as far as I'm concerned, the water is reasonable. Now, I have a survey out in St. John's County and Volusia County trying to do county by county comparison, just so people have a feel for whether or not Flagler County or Palm Coast knows how to run a water utility. You could say none of us know how to run a water utility, and me being a rookie, I can say, you know, I'm more of a citizen than I am a politician, but each day that goes by, you know, I can't hide behind the citizen thing very much longer. But anyhow, let's hear what is all in store, and that way you'll be better informed about how the scope of what the water utility does and how important it is to this county's vibrancy and its future, more so. So thank you.
I'd like to start first by introducing you all to my direct reports. Hopefully they're standing right outside the hallway so that you can at least put a face to the name, and they're the folks that you're going to be able to ask questions of later in the evening. Okay, we're a large department. We're over half the city. So what you see here are my direct reports, and I'll introduce you to each one of them. You'll get to talk to these folks throughout the evening. They'll be mingling amongst you, and so there will be a lot of questions you have you can ask them and their staff. First is Cynthia Jessup, Customer Service Manager. Danny Ashburn, Wastewater Operations Manager. Jim Hogan, Water Operations Manager. Randy Zaleski is Water Distribution Manager. Steve Flanagan, Utility Development. Terry Jarvis is our office manager, and she's my right hand, has been for years. Tony Capella is street superintendent, and then Brian Matthews is our environmental specialist. I'll tell you a little bit about what each of them do and each of their departments do, but at least you've met them face to face, and then they can you can ask them questions later. So we'll let them go about and finish preparing the meal and get the stations ready so that you can ask them the questions later on.
I always knew that I liked this place. You don't have to look too far to find a friendly face. I feel alive when I'm walking on this street. I feel the heart of the city pounding underneath my feet. Yeah, let the world keep spinning round and round. This is where it all goes down, down, down. That's why I love this town. That's why I keep coming round. Say hey, say yeah, say yeah. You make me feel at home somehow, right now. That's why I love this town. That's why I love this town. No matter where you're from tonight, you're from right here. This is where it all goes down, down, down. That's why I love this town. Say hey, say yeah, say yeah. I love this town.
So, Public Works is really where operations and maintenance. We have a number of areas where we're responsible. The streets, roads, medians, landscapes, sidewalks, pathways, signage. Drainage, drainage maintenance. You've already been through the Stormwater Department's Citizens Academy. We do the maintenance. Parks, again, you've been through Parks and Rec, but we do the maintenance of the parks. We maintain all the city facilities, buildings, the city fleet, trucks, heavy equipment, small engine equipment, and then, of course, the utility, water, sewer, reuse, meter reading, and customer service. We operate the customer service call center. So a little bit about my staff, then we'll talk about the facilities, and then what it is we do. First of all, these are the direct reports, and I introduced you to those folks a minute ago. Terry Jarvis, office manager over at the utility office. She's my assistant, does general administrative duties, typical office management type stuff, prepares the purchase requisitions for the purchasing department, performance measures, various reports, those kinds of things. Tony Capella, street superintendent. This is the largest division amongst our group. It's about almost half the employees. That's all the roads, the drainage, the landscape signs, fleet, parks, and facilities. Jim Hogan is in charge of water treatment and the raw water supply, all the wells, the water quality at the tap, and maintaining the fire hydrants. Cynthia Jessup is our customer service manager, operates the call center. When you call the 2360 number, the phone will be answered by her group. Also operates the front desk down at the city offices at 2 Utility Drive, the utility office, and the main city hall. They receive the payments, and they prepare all the work orders for the field crews to do their work. Danny Ashburn's our wastewater operations manager. He's in charge of the wastewater collection system, wastewater treatment, and then, of course, effluent disposal and the residuals disposal. Brian Matthews is kind of an in-house watchdog. He monitors all our compliance activities. We have dozens of permits, and we do thousands of tests, and he coordinates all that with the laboratory contract. All our compliance sampling is all tested at an independent laboratory, not a city laboratory, and he coordinates that contract and makes sure that we maintain all our permits in good order. Randy Zaleski, our utility water distribution system manager, and he's in charge of all the meters, meter reading, meter installations, and the materials inventory for water and sewer. And then Steve Flanagan, our manager of utility development, he coordinates all the utility work with new developers, new customers, or any utility expansions, capital expansions, new plants, and those kinds of things. He also maintains our construction details and standards. So our facilities. Basically, we have six main facilities, with several other facilities, but our six main facilities are comprised of the Streets Division office and yard. It's just down the road on US 1. And it houses all the streets, the sign shop. We have a full scale sign shop where we make all the signs for the city. That's where they house all the equipment for the streets maintenance. That's where we have the fleet maintenance shop. They take care of all the small equipment, all the vehicles, large trucks, and that's also where we stage most of our streets operations out of, and house these goofy looking strange devices like the street sweeper. The utility administration offices over on 2 Utility Drive, that's the main office for the utility division. Most of you have probably been there one time or another, sign up for service. That's where we stage all the utility operations out of. So the fleet of utility vehicles are over there, and all the specialized equipment like this little vacuum cleaner for utility work. We also have an inventory of pieces, parts, and for repairs and expansions, and that's held at the utility office. Then we have three water treatment plants. Water treatment plant number one is on Corporate Drive North, which is Palm Coast Parkway. You may have seen that sign along Palm Coast Parkway westbound. It's a conventional lime softening facility. It was originally built in 1979 as a 2 million gallon a day facility. And it was later expanded to 6 million gallons a day in 1982, and that's the size of it right now, 6 million gallon a day plant. Water treatment plant number two is down south of State Road 100. It's on Citation. It's a membrane softening facility, which is basically low pressure reverse osmosis. We take fresh water from the ground. We want to soften it. We use low pressure reverse osmosis. Same process as desalination, only it's lower pressure because we don't have any salt in the water. It was built in 1992 as a 2 million gallon a day plant. The year that was built and opened up, it was the first plant of its type in this entire hemisphere to use low pressure reverse osmosis to soften fresh water. And now this is pretty much the standard in the industry. Palm Coast has always been progressive and keeping up with the latest technology, and this plant is proof that way back in 1992 we had the vision that this was the way water treatment was going to go, and that's virtually every plant is built that way these days. It was expanded to 3.19 million gallons a day in 2003 and later expanded in 2004 to 6.38 million gallons a day, and that's its current capacity. Water treatment plant number three is where you are right now. It's also a low-pressure reverse osmosis facility. And it's also designed to treat brackish water. So if at a later date we get the approval from the Water Management District to go deeper and pull out brackish water, water that is slightly salty, this facility can treat brackish water. It was completed in 2008 as a 3 million gallon a day facility, and that's its current size. You'll get to tour this whole plant at the last segment of this evening. And then the water reclamation facility, better known to most people as the sewer plant. We call it water reclamation because we do reclaim the water. It's an extended aeration to oxidation ditch. Actually, there's three ditches. That's the overview of it, and you may notice that there's all kinds of things going on here. This is utility drive. There's Wood Haven condos. The Woodlands is all around here, hidden in there amongst the community, and most people don't even know it's there. It's been five stages of construction over the years to its current capacity of 6.83 million gallons a day. The latest expansion was completed in 2006, just a couple years after the city acquired the utility. So additionally, we have 46 water supply wells, 12 more under construction. 40 of those are in the intermediate aquifer. That's the intermediate aquifer, the confined surficial aquifer, whatever you want to call it. Those wells are only 60 to 80 feet deep. They're pulling from a sand shell layer that's not real prolific, so we have to have multiple wells to get the small amount of water that we're talking about. And then we have six wells in the Floridan aquifer. Now, in most of Palm Coast, the Floridan aquifer is brackish, but in the southwest part of Palm Coast, there is a section of the Floridan aquifer that is fresh, so we tap that aquifer for water treatment plant number two. That's a typical well. You may have seen these around. If you live in the Pine Lakes area, you see these kind of scattered in Pine Lakes up along US 1, and then we go out west of west from there. We have over 600 miles of water mains. All those water mains buried under the ground. We have over 600 miles of wastewater pipelines. As you can see, some of those are very, very deep, can get in upwards of 20 feet deep in the gravity sewer area. We have six water storage tanks, 7.5 million gallons of water stored in tanks, up to 7.5 million gallons. So we, all day long, we're making water 24/7, and we're filling those tanks when the demand is low and draining those tanks when the demand is high. These plants, all three water plants, operate and are staffed 24 hours a day. That tank probably looks familiar, that 750,000 gallon tank along I-95. And that tank is on A1A and it holds 400,000 gallons. We also have over 3,700 fire hydrants ready at a drop of a hat for the fire department to hook up and put out a fire. Over 43,000 meters that we read every single month. 141 wastewater pump stations, most of which look something like that. You might see those around the neighborhood. Those are wastewater pump stations designed to collect the waste in your neighborhood and pump it to the plant. 12,000 PEP units. If you live in a PEP area, you know what that is. If you don't, it's a septic tank that's in your yard. But instead of draining to a drain field and perking into the ground, it drains into this little pump chamber, and that pump pumps the effluent out into the wastewater collection system and onto the wastewater plant. We have three wastewater effluent disposal sites. Most of our wastewater effluent, treated effluent, it's prepared for public access reuse, and most of it is used for irrigation, especially during dry periods. It's used to irrigate hammock dunes, golf courses, common areas, residential areas. It's used to irrigate all of town center, and it's used to irrigate Grand Haven Golf Course and common areas, and we have a couple of small communities like Hidden Lakes where it's used to irrigate residential properties. Now, so you drive through town center and you see the town center community development district maintains all that property in there, and you wonder who's maintaining that? That's the grant, that's the town center CDD, that's not the city. And you wonder how come they can water in the middle of the day when you can't? That's because they are using 100% reuse and they're allowed to water anytime because we're glad to get rid of it. And they pay us for it. And we have one effluent pumping facility, speaking of town center. That's our reuse pumping filter facility. So we actually have a storage lake down there where we put the reuse effluent into the storage lake and we repump it into the irrigation system for town center. And we also own a city fueling facility where all the city vehicles are fueled. So what do we do? That list, as I showed you a little earlier, we'll break it down a little bit. In the streets department, we maintain all the roads. We maintain all the medians and landscapes. Now you see on Palm Coast Parkway, you'll see Fox Landscaping out there, trimming the bushes out there. Well, Fox Landscaping works for the city as a contract, and we're responsible for those medians as well. We maintain all the sidewalks and pathways, which we're getting more and more every day. So there's like 100 miles of pathways in Palm Coast. So we're responsible for all the maintenance of those, and of course, all the signage, traffic lights, and all those things in Palm Coast. So the typical kind of work, a little roadside shoulder work. We work on guardrails. We do all the mowing. We cut back all the overgrowth. Pick up litter. We got people that all they do every day is pick up litter. Trim up palm trees, fix signs, pour new sidewalks, repair old sidewalks. We have a sign shop. I mentioned that. We maintain over 11,000 street signs, 48 traffic signals. We replace any down sign. We get calls in the middle of the night from the sheriff's department, stop signs down. We get up out of bed and we go fix that stop sign in the middle of the night. We assist in road closures and detours, accidents and things like that. And we also assist in special events, especially traffic control. So when you have the parade, you'll see all those cones and things out there. That's us. Our drainage, you had your stormwater presentation last week. Well, we do the maintenance, swales, ditches, and culvert pipes. And one of our biggest operations, of course, is the swale rehab program. And they probably talked a lot about that last week. We get our plans directly from the engineering and stormwater department, and we do what they tell us to do. We also have a little vacuum cleaner to clean out culvert pipes. We replace culvert pipes that rot out. After 30 years, we got a lot of rotting out culvert pipes. So those are things that we do, is replace those on a fairly regular basis. We also maintain all the parks, the recreation areas, sports fields, and the trails. So the parks, I wonder if everybody realizes we have that many parks. Holland Park, Linear Park, Waterfront Park, Indian Trail Sports Complex, Ralph Carter Park, Seminole Woods Park, Tennis Center, and the sidewalks and trails. Everybody realize we have that many. It's excellent recreational opportunities. Here we are just doing some resodding of one of the ball fields, fixing up the dugouts. There we're pouring some new decking at the swimming pool, at Frida Zamba Swimming Pool. We're responsible for all these boardwalks and trails and all those kinds of things. And then we are in charge of city facilities, although we don't have to do a whole lot over at City Hall because we don't own it, we rent it. The rest of the city buildings we maintain. We also have a fleet division. Our fleet division is, and you may have learned a little bit about this in the finance department, basically fleet is an internal service fund. Our fleet division leases trucks to the other departments. So we do all the maintenance, over 184 vehicles, 134 pieces of light equipment, 107 pieces of heavy equipment. If one breaks down in the road, we have to send the mechanic out to fix it. And we also occasionally have a job that's too big for us to handle. We got to put a new transmission in one of those great big dump trucks. So our fleet division manages any kind of contract maintenance. And then the utility, we talked a lot about utility already, the water supply and treatment, wastewater collection, the reuse system, and all the meter reading and billing. And we operate the customer service call center. and handle all those customer accounts. And the customer service also handles other areas besides water and sewer. They do the stormwater billing and responding to customer calls on stormwater and solid waste.
A street sweeper came whistling by, he was bouncing every step. It seemed strange how good he felt, so I asked him while he swept. He said, it's my job to be cleaning up this mess, and that's enough reason to go for me. It's my job to be better than the rest, and that makes a day for me. It's my job different than the rest, and that's enough a reason to go for me. It's my job to be better than the rest, and that's a rough break for me. It's my job to be cleaning up this mess, and that's enough a reason to go for me. It's my job to be better than the rest, and that makes a day for me.
Okay, that is the quick overview of the Public Works Department. Now what we're going to do now is we're going to cut you loose. When you go out this door, you go down the hallway all the way to the end, back outside, and there'll be several employees out there that will be able to answer all the questions that you've come up with during this presentation.
I'm Fred Griner. I'm with the City of Palm Coast. Obviously, that's why you're here. I've been here since 1995. I started as a trainee, worked my way up to a chief operator. I'm the chief operator over at Water Plant 2. You guys are in Water Plant 3's lab. Basically, every day we come in and we grab samples from our permeate and concentrate, which I'll explain to you guys later, and our raw water. And basically, you know, we are required by the state to provide safe, potable drinking water to all of our consumers. If we were not able to do that, if we could actually go to jail for that. So I just want to let you guys know. I tell this to everybody while I'm in the lab. Your water is very safe to drink. So I know there's a lot of people that have speculations on, you know, getting a water softener, doing this, doing that. Your water, by us, we're required to bring it to you, safe, potable to your taps, to your home.
You drink it yourself?
I drink it myself. Yeah, so I didn't lose my hair because of it, to be honest. But yes, I drink it myself. I'm fine. So I just want to kind of show you guys. I'm going to run by one of our samples, kind of show you how we do it. It's really, we use titration a lot, and it's really kind of simple how we record our results. Basically, you know, we'll get a sample. And this sample would really be representative of probably what's in the high service pump. Let's see.
Is water coming through there or just regular?
This is regular tap water. And figures. I don't have a stir. No, we'll get our samples from typically the high service pump. But this is a representative of what you'll see out of the high service pump. If I was to grab a sample from that, it would be pretty much equivalent to what this is. And I'm trying to figure out where they get their stirs. So I'll just do this. Okay, you see that? See how the water is now purple? Because I put in a powder pillow, total hardness. I go ahead, put 5 drops of this in. And when it changes colors, that's how we know the hardness level in the water. And I would typically have a magnetic stirrer in here, But now that I'm on camera and I don't know where they keep them, I'm just going to kind of spin it. And you can see how it's starting to turn to a blue. And as it gets to the blue point, stop, we record it. We multiply that by 20, so the hardness is right around 96 coming out of the tap. The raw water hardness is relatively 320, 330. The water coming off of the trains would really be a real soft water. It would be between, could be as low as 10 to 30. We add hardness back to the water for a couple of reasons. Water that soft is really aggressive and can be corrosive. And another thing is I don't know if you've ever had a water softener or just like with nanofiltration or reverse osmosis, if you have a real soft water and you go to take a shower, sometimes when you get the soap on you and it doesn't come off, that's because you have really, really, really soft water. So just because the water is really soft doesn't make it, you know, it can sometimes make it more difficult for you than actually, you know, better. So, okay, water plant three, basically, just like all the other water plants, we have raw water that we pull from the aquifers. Plant one and plant three pull from the confined surficial. Plant two pulls from the Floridan. So right now they're well field, and plant ones, they're really in a very similar location, and they pull from the confined surficial. They're able to turn the wells on through telemetry by pushing a button on the computer that activates a well. Well turns on, comes into what we call our Hydac sand separator. And what the sand separator is, you have 18 cylindrical stainless steel filters in each one of these. And as the water flows through, it gets filtered. This one right here is primarily, I believe it is 25 micron. Visible to the eye is 70, so it's removing particulates in the water that the human eye can't see. And the reason for that is because the membranes that are in the pressure vessels are extremely expensive, and we feel like if we could remove as many particulates from the raw water that can damage a membrane prior to going in them, the longer the life of the membranes, the less of the cost of the consumer later on. The water coming in, it's very scale forming, got a lot of calcium magnesium in it. So what we basically do, feed an anti-scalant to prevent scaling in the second stage. As the water flows through the membranes, the first stage, which is the majority of the pressure vessels, they end up getting the majority of the fouling from that occurs from biological fouling. The second stage, the water slows down a little bit more. The issue that we have in the second stage would be scaling. So we feed an anti-scalant to prevent that. And then eventually the trains do end up getting scaled up to a point where we have to do a cleaning. And that's what these tanks are right here. We end up feeding a mild acidified solution to clean the second stage. And then we also feed a high pH to remove the biofouling that occurs in the first stage. So just to kind of go over what we've done so far, we've turned a well on. The wells go through the Hydac unit. The Hydac unit removes some particulates up to 25 micron. We feed a scale inhibitor to prevent scaling to occur in the second stage. Now the water heads over to the cartridge filters. Right now, this is our cartridge can. In these cans are 75 micron string wound filters. And what they basically do, they look like balls of yarn wrapped up on a tube. The water comes in, hits the string wound cartridges. The cartridge filters remove as low as 5 micron. So you had 25 micron there. You have 5 moving as low as 5 microns here. And again, the primary goal is to reduce any kind of particulates damaging the first stage elements. So by doing that, these cartridges right here cost you roughly $6 a piece. One element there cost you right around $400. So the goal is to replace these before you have to replace those. That's primarily the reason why we feed, that's why we use the cartridge filters in front. And every nanofiltration reverse osmosis system will have cartridge filters to protect their elements. And this right here is our feed pump. It elevates the pressure. The raw water pressure alone is not enough to push the water through the last element of the second stage. So we have to elevate the pressure, and that's what the feed pumps will do. Now, as the water goes through, the pressure is elevated. As you can see, it goes through. You'll see you have two banks of filters right here. You have this bank right here, would be your first stage, and you got an alone set, which is your second stage. Water from the feed pump goes through the first stage elements first. Okay, as the water goes through, it separates the divalent ions from the water. Basically, what it removes is the vast majority of any contaminants that you have in the raw water. The one thing it will not remove is dissolved gases such as hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide. But it essentially removes every harmful pollutant that you're going to have in the water. So as the water flows through, you have your 16 elements in your first stage, feeds this way. Your second stage actually feeds from the backside coming forward. And on the backside, you'll have a booster pump that elevates the pressure for your second stage to be able to force it through. And now what you've done is you recovered 50% of the water in your first stage, 50% of the water in your second stage, which is really 75% because you have half of the elements in your second stage. So the other 25% of the water is what we call concentrate. Whatever we removed from here is what ends up being put into our concentrate. Our concentrate used to go to the this facility used to go to the intercoastal. Now we've been able to establish that we can actually treat that water even further to get 100% recovery. And what we do is we send that water over to water plant one, which is a lime softening plant, and they're able to remove the constituents from that by lime softening. So we don't discharge at this facility anymore into the intercoastal. Everything right now from this plant is 100% recovered. These are your high service pumps. When we go outside, this is actually what's going to supply your pressure to your taps. The typical pressure that we run, each plant is different. Plant one basically runs right around 60 PSI. Plant two is between 65 and 70, and this plant is relatively the same, right around 60. So, and when we go outside, you'll see that the water that feeds this comes off the 2 million gallon tank. As we walk around the back of the building, you'll see it. This right here is a corrosion inhibitor. Basically, we feed this in to prevent corrosion into your pipes. This is a pilot that Water Plant 3 is running. Right now, what they're trying to do is try to reduce their iron content of their concentrate, the water that they're sending to Plant 1. They're trying different things to be able to reduce color so it lightens the load over at Water Plant 1. As of right now, it's on its infancy stages of trying to figure out what's going to work best. But those are actually basically like mixed media filters that Plant 1 would have, but just on a way smaller scale. You can see this is their control room. They're able to monitor what's going on outside, front gate, the train area, the high service pumps that we were looking at. This is their SCADA system. That's an overview of basically the facility. You can see the ground storage tank. If I was to click on it, it gives you an idea of what the tank level is in the ground storage tank. That ground storage tank is 2 million gallons. You can see the high service flow right now leaving is 560 gallons a minute. The tank is 17 foot tall, or 17 foot full. Right here is the building that you're in. Right here, these are the trains that you were just looking at. Right here is train B. You can see right now he has train B on, as indicated by the green light. Green is go, so everything is running. The feed pressure going in is 92 PSI. Each train, if you look at, makes a total permeate at this plant right now of 650 gallons a minute. And that varies from plant to plant and depending on your needs. We recover a little bit more over a plant two than here. So this is not just a view. We actually have capabilities, just like the other telemetry, starting wells up, shutting them down. I just wanted to show you guys that real quick. This is the emergency generator room. Kind of gives you an idea of the the generator, if it's running, if it's not. It's got load testing data and stuff like that. Everything that on the computer, I don't even know if I can open this. Here we go again. Basically, our SCADA system kind of runs off of this line, right? These lines right here. Whenever you make a change, or when you see a process variable or anything that's on that computer with the overview, when you're hitting buttons or whenever an analyzer is giving you a reading, it comes through our SCADA system, and it ends up, giving us the displays on the computer, kind of show us what we have, and it allows us to be able to turn stuff on and off, whether it's a well, pump, have you. The water that comes off the trains, remember, it comes in as raw. It comes out in two streams, permeate and concentrate. I talked to you guys about the concentrate. That's the water that's going to water plant one. That's the water that all the minerals were collected in. The permeate is the clean water that's very low in hardness, very low in minerals, very low in basically everything. So we add raw water to bring the hardness back up to make it less aggressive and make it more stable. But I also told you guys, the membranes will remove a lot, but it won't remove gases. So what we do is we basically take the permeate and put it through a degasser. The water goes in through the top. On the back side of those degassers, there's a pipe that actually the permeate comes in, feeds through the top, and as it trickles down, there's a bunch of media or packing that basically look like wiffle balls. And as the water hits the wiffle balls, it's separating the water and the gas molecules, and the blowers are blowing the air up. So as it's the water's separating from the gases are getting blown up to the top vent to degasify the water, to remove the hydrogen sulfide, to remove the carbon dioxide, to remove any gases that could be harmful. All right, this is basically our sodium hydroxide. These are the pumps that sodium hydroxide is used to raise the pH. Okay, because as the permeate goes through the membranes, the raw water coming in is a 7. The permeate gets reduced down to about a 5.5 because, like I said before, we remove the dissolved gases, or the membranes don't remove gases. Carbon dioxide is a gas. Carbon dioxide lowers the pH because it's acidic. So therefore, we degas it, the pH comes up a little. We add sodium hydroxide, caustic, basically, to raise the pH up even more to make the water more stable. And these are basically the pumps that do that. These tanks are double containment. They're a tank within a tank. So if you had a tank, the tank leak, all it's gonna do is basically fill up to the inside of this tank right here. We have these touch pads throughout the plant that basically, if an operator's here by himself and something occurs, whether a train crashes or high service pump trips out or anything, they could come here, and it's the same screen that we had over there, overview. So if they're in this building, they're able to see, check alarms, see what's going on, and be able to react to it. And you can see they have alarms there, plant chlorine, and those are analyzers. So he'll go check and make sure his sample compares to what they have on the analyzer. And it's the same thing. I mean, you got train B that's online. You have the ground storage tank, you have 17 foot of water in it, high service flow. And it's being here by yourself, it gives you an opportunity of working on other equipment without having to run back to the other building to make sure the plant's still running. It gives you an opportunity of getting other things done. This is our cooking room, also our generator room. As you guys can smell the peanut oil. This is the generator again that basically whenever the plant goes down, this generator will automatically kick on and run the plant continuously for days on end. Yes, it's big. And it, like I said, it basically went, as soon as power is lost here, this generator automatically switches over, and you basically, you may have to start up a pump and then start the plant back up, but generally you won't lose anything. This site is also going to be the home of the new wastewater plant. So when the wastewater plant is built, they're going to have their own generator as well.
What we will do is go to the big machine behind us, the Vacon, and clean it. Clean that area first, and then we stick this camera in and see what's going on with the pipe. Where it might be broke, we took the problems we're having internally. And of course, we record everything.
You guys are a bunch of Sherlock Holmes hanging out there. Sure.
You gotta figure it out somehow.
That's true.
If I can pull up on here, if we have a leak, I can hit line shutdown, and it'll tell me how many people are out of water, how many hydrants are out of water, how many valves are shut down. That way you don't have to look it up.
That helps you be more efficient.
Very efficient.
Wonderful. Good job, Joe.
Thank you.
Well, I'm impressed with everything. You know, I'm not that good with understanding a lot of this stuff, but I just like the presentations that everybody's giving.
Well, thank you, ma'am.
And you're bringing it down to, for me, lay people, to understand.
Right.
So I think it makes a big difference. Keep up the good work.
Thank you, ma'am. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
This experience here at the Public Works, which I thought was just a water plant, but I didn't realize that they covered as much territory. And I feel that is a mind blower. I never realized or thought too much about water, where it comes from, how it's taken care of. We have a general public has a general idea that our water is taken care of and that's it. But you have no idea of what it goes through, none at all.
I guess the biggest surprise for me was how clean and well furbished the facility is. I mean, it's like a milk treatment plant instead of a water plant. Everything was spotless. Everybody was very, very knowledgeable. Any question you had, if they didn't know the answer, they went and found somebody that did.